In this video, we're going to be looking at the ultra-low power, or ULP, coprocessor on the ESP32. This is a really interesting and powerful feature on the ESP32 that offers some very exciting functionality. Now, it's worth having a watch of the previous deep sleep video. There's a link in the description, and it contains some really useful information. So why am I actually looking at the ULP? Well, one of my latest projects is a DIY e-reader. For this, I want to use deep sleep mode to preserve battery life. The board I've got comes with a set of buttons, and I've written the software so that it can be used with just three buttons: up, down, and select. EXT1 sleep mode would be ideal for this. It can monitor multiple buttons and can tell you which button was pushed. But it can only do this if the buttons are active high. Looking at the schematic for the board I have, the buttons all have external pull-up resistors. This means that they are active low and can't be used by EXT1 sleep mode. With the ULP coprocessor, we have a lot more flexibility. We can write code that runs on the ULP coprocessor waiting for one of our buttons to go low. We can then wake the device up when that happens, and we can tell it which button was pushed. It's pretty cool. So what are we going to cover in this video? I'll describe what the ULP processor is. We'll do a quick run through of the instruction set that can be used to program the ULP. I'll show you how to use it in PlatformIO and the Arduino IDE. I'll then run through some examples that will show you how to read values from GPIO pins, wake up the main processor, share data between the ULP coprocessor and the main processor, and then we'll write values out to GPIO pins. We'll do a simple blink sketch that runs entirely on the ULP processor. Now, there are some advanced use cases, including reading from the ADC and I2C devices, that we'll cover in future videos. So we'll get started after this quick word about the channel sponsor, PCBWay. They've been sponsoring the channel for a while now, and we've built a few PCBs with them. We'll be making some more PCBs in the future videos, as I want to learn a bit more about KiCad. They also do 3D printing and CNC work. Check out the link to PCBWay in the description. So, what is this ULP coprocessor thing anyway? The expressive docs describe it as the following. The ultra-low power coprocessor is a simple finite state machine which is designed to perform measurements using the ADC, temperature sensor, and external I2C sensors, while the main processors are in deep sleep mode. Now, although they describe it as a simple finite state machine, it's slightly easier to think of it as a very basic low-power processor that can run code even when the main processors are asleep. The ULP processor does not run all the time. You schedule it to run with a set time period. It runs, and then when the ULP program completes, it stops running until the next scheduled time. To program the ULP, we use some simple assembly language. Don't let this put you off, it really is very simple and not something to be afraid of. If you're using Arduino, then there's also a very basic C compiler that you can use. The ULP coprocessor has four 16-bit general purpose registers, labelled R0, R1, R2 and R3. It also has an extra 8-bit register called stage count, which can be used to implement loops and has some special instructions. It may help to imagine these registers as variables in a normal C program. There are 26 instructions in total. I've tried to group these into logical areas. There are three instructions for getting values into our registers. The move instruction will move a value from one register to another, or it will load an immediate value into a register. The store instruction will store the contents of a register into a memory address contained in another register with an optional signed offset. The load instruction does the opposite. It reads from the contents of memory from an address in a register with an optional signed offset as well. We have two arithmetic instructions, add and sub. As the name suggests, these instructions let you add and subtract values. We can either add or subtract registers, or we can add and subtract numbers from registers. We also have a set of bitwise operators, AND, OR, logical shift left and logical shift right. These all behave in the same way as the bitwise operators in C and C++. We then have three jump commands. We have the absolute jump command. This can jump to an address in a register or to an immediate address. It also supports two conditions: EQ, which will be true if the last ALU operation resulted in a zero, or OV, which will be true if the last ALU operation resulted in an overflow. In this example, we set R0 to 1 and then AND it with the value 1. The result of this is non-zero, so the first jump fails. The second jump has no condition, so it jumps. This sample code is the equivalent of a C if else construction. Then we have the relative jump R command. This will jump based on the contents of the R0 register and a threshold. And the last jump instruction is the jump S command. This will jump based on the contents of the stage count register and a threshold. This leads us on to the specific stage count instructions. We have stage reset, which will reset the stage count, stage inc, which will increment the stage count, and finally we have stage dec, which will decrement the stage count register. You can use these instructions in conjunction with the jump S command to implement simple for loops. We then have the commands for controlling the ULP execution. The halt command will end the current ULP program, and the ULP processor will stop running until it's woken again by the timer. The wake command wakes up the main processor. We'll discuss this in a bit, as there are some caveats on when the main processor can be woken. The wait command delays for a number of cycles. We then have a set of instructions for reading from peripherals. T-sends will read from the internal ESP32 temperature sensor. ADC will read a value from the analog to digital converter. And we have a couple of functions for reading from an I2C slave device. We'll cover these instructions in a future video. You can find more detailed documentation at this link. I've added this to the video description. So how do we actually create a program for the ULP and run it? Let's have a look at the process with PlatformIO first. PlatformIO supports ULP programming, but only if you are targeting the ESP IDF. If you want to use Arduino code, then you'll need to use the Arduino framework as a component. Adding support for the ULP is pretty straightforward. We need to create a folder and add a file containing our ULP code. This must have a capital S as the extension. Here I've added a very simple program that will wake up immediately. We need to make the project aware of this file by modifying the CMakeList text file in the source folder. The first line defines a name for our ULP app. The second line tells the compiler which files contain our ULP code. The third line tells the compiler which of our files will be using any variables exported by the ULP code. And the fourth line actually embeds the ULP binary blob in our project. If we try and build now, we'll get an error. We need to allocate space for our ULP program and enable the ULP processor. We do this by running menu config. In PlatformIO, you do this by opening up the PlatformIO terminal and then running PIO run -t menu config. We then need to go to component config, ESP32 specific, and enable the ultra low power ULP coprocessor. By default, this will reserve 512 bytes of RTC memory for our code. With that saved, our project now builds successfully. Our last job is to actually load the embedded ULP code into the coprocessor and run it. In our main CPP file, we can now include an automatically generated header file, ulp-main.h. This contains any variables that have been exposed by our ULP program. We'll talk about this in a bit. We also have two external constants that point to the start and end of our embedded ULP binary. If we weren't woken up by the ULP processor, then we load up our ULP binary. I've set up the code to wait for a button press. As soon as the button is pressed, we go into deep sleep. We enable ULP wake up, set the period. In this case, I'm just setting the period to be around 5 seconds, as my ULP program will wake up the main processor immediately. We then run our ULP program and go into deep sleep. So I've run this up on the device, and if we push the button, you can see that after about 5 seconds, our device wakes up again, and the wake cause is the ULP processor. If you're using the Arduino IDE, then there is a plugin that you can install called ULP Tool. There are instructions in the README for this. I won't run through the setup, as it does vary depending on the operating system you are using. The main difference between this and the PlatformIO or ESP-IDF approach is that the files must have a lowercase s for the file extension. So how do we wake up the main processor from the ULP coprocessor? This is as simple as issuing the wake instruction. However, there is a bit of boilerplate code that needs to be run before this. We need to make sure that the RTC controller is ready to wake up the main processor. To check for this, we need to monitor the ready for wake up bit on the RTC control low power status register. The read RTC field macro is a helper that you can use to read a set of bits from this register. If the bit is low, then we are not ready to wake up the main processor. We check for the low bit by adding the value in R0 with 1. If the result of this is 0, then the EQ flag will be true and we'll try again. If the result is not 0, then the EQ flag will be false and will issue the wake instruction. We make use of the stage counter register here so that we only try and wake up 10 times before giving up. This prevents our ULP program from getting stuck forever. Reading from GPIO pins is pretty straightforward, with a couple of gotchas for the unwary. We need to set up the GPIO pins in our main program so that they can be used by the RTC controller. We cover this in more detail in the previous Deep Sleep video, but you do this using the RTC GPIO commands. In our ULP code, we use the readRTCReg macro. We use this to read values from the RTC GPIO in register. If we look in the ESP32 technical manual, we can see that this register contains the values for the RTC GPIO pins in bits 14 up to bit 31. The bit will be 1 if the GPIO is high, and 0 if the GPIO is low. These bits correspond to the RTC GPIO 0 in bit 14 up to RTC GPIO 17 in bit 31. We can only read 16 bits at a time, as our registers R0 to R3 are all 16 bits. The command shown on the screen will read the 16 bits from the register starting from the bit position specified by RTC GPIO next S into register R0. RTC GPIO next S is defined to be 14, so it starts reading at bit 14. As we can only read 16 bits at a time, if we want to read RTC GPIO 16 and 17, we need to adjust the starting bit position. The code shown here will place the value for RTC GPIO 16 in bit 14 and RTC GPIO 17 in bit 15. Armed with this knowledge, we can now write a ULP program that will monitor the pins on my e-paper board. The pins I want to monitor are GPIO number 34, GPIO number 35, and GPIO number 39. You'll recall from our previous video that there is a mapping from RTC pins to GPIO pins. We can use this mapping to work out which bits we need to check for our GPIO pins. GPIO number 39 is RTC GPIO number 3, and GPIO number 34 is RTC GPIO number 4. GPIO number 35 is RTC GPIO number 5. The code for checking if these bits are low is very similar to the code that checks if we are ready to wake up. We read in the current GPIO values from the register, and then we AND the value with the bit that corresponds to the RTC pin we are interested in. GPIO number 34 is pin 4. If the result of this is 0, then the pin must be low. We do this for the other GPIO pins we are interested in. GPIO number 39 is pin 3, and GPIO number 35 is pin 5. Now, this is all very interesting, and we can now wake up the device when the user pushes the buttons. But this is no different from the EXT1 mode that we used in the previous video. We need some way of knowing which button actually woke us up. We need to get data from the ULP processor to the main processor. This is actually surprisingly easy to do. In our ULP code, we can mark labels as being global. Doing this exposes them to our application code as global variables, prefixed with the value ULP underscore. We can read and write into these addresses, and the values will be available in our main code. We can also put values into these variables from our main code, and the values will be available to the ULP. With that done, we can now detect which button actually woke us in our application code. In our ULP code, we're writing the value we read from the GPIO register, and then our application code just needs to check this to see which GPIO pin was low. One thing to be aware of is that only the bottom 16 bits of the variable will contain data, as our ULP registers are all 16 bits. You can check out my e-reader code to see a more detailed and flexible example of this. So how about writing to GPIO pins? Is that possible? Let's make a blink sketch that runs entirely on the ULP. We can see from the serial output that we've gone into deep sleep. Looking at our code, we don't have anything writing to the LED. Everything is happening on the ULP. To set output values, we use the RCT GPIO out reg. GPIO 2, which is where our built-in LED is connected, maps onto RTC 12, which is bit 26 of the register. There's a couple of extra hoops to jump through in order to maintain the state of our output when the ULP program is not running. We need to set the hold bit of the pad. So before we change the value, we need to clear the hold bit. We then read the current value of the pin. We use the readRTCReg macro here and use the RTC GPIO out data S macro, adding on 12 to get the bit for the RTC GPIO 12. If the bit is currently set, then we clear it. If the bit is not set, then we set it. We then put the hold bit back onto the pad and finish our program. In our application code, we've scheduled the ULP program to run every 500 milliseconds, so it keeps blinking until we reset the device. Check out my previous video that explores deep sleep and wake up using the built-in functionality of the ESP32, as you often don't need to use the ULP at all. There's a whole bunch more really interesting applications that we can do using the ADC and I2C peripherals and the ULP. We'll be covering these in a future video. See you soon!